What's up, everyone? I am Charlie Shrem, and you are listening to Untold Stories, where twice a week, and I wish more, I get to dive deep with some of crypto's most influential leaders, past, present, and future, to really understand how this movement came to be and where the hell are we going. And on today's show, I get to hang out for the next 40 minutes with a person who I consider a friend, Alex Adelman, the founder and CEO of Lolli. Thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Thanks for having me, Charlie.
We got to, last time we got to hang out, eToro was throwing a party in some basement somewhere. This is like pre-COVID times. By the way, eToro is not my sponsor, but great company. And so they threw this party and we were down there together. And you were telling me about your company. You were just launching it and I had very briefly heard about it. And I don't know if you remember, I was like very excited to meet you because I like putting faces to the names. And then I registered and I started using it. And let's while you explain to everyone what you do, if they don't know already, if they've been living under a rock, I'm going to log into my Lolli account now in my browser and see how much money I've earned. Because I believe in the past year, I've probably earned more Bitcoin than I've bought. But let's check.
Wow, that's awesome.
Now we're going to check right now.
Let's see.
Well, so what I have to log in and see. Yeah, dude, I don't know if you've checked. I just withdrew like $200 worth of Bitcoin on Lolli like a few weeks ago.
That's awesome.
It was great.
Yeah, I mean, we have users that have earned like multiple Bitcoin at this point. It's wild. Like I think as you know, like you know, using it for travel is probably one of the biggest earning. So like hotels, flights, that kind of thing.
Marriott is actually where I earned a huge percentage of Bitcoin back.
Yeah. For those that don't know, we're a Bitcoin rewards company. We give people Bitcoin when they do something that they're already going to do, which is shop online or travel. We make it really easy. Takes 30 seconds to download. There's very minimal KYC. So super easy onboarding. And then people can start earning doing what they're already going to do.
I remember like in the early days of Bitcoin talking about using crypto as like a loyalty aspect of companies rewarding loyalty, use us, you get cash back. The model, the industry is a billion dollar industry. But most people don't realize that there's only like really you and then your competitor are the two largest ones and pretty much the only ones that are doing what you're doing. But for years, there are a lot of failed companies, even through the ICO world, like hundreds of them to try to do this exact same thing. Why did they fail? What do you think are the biggest caveats or the biggest like hurdles that you had to overcome to get people to start using it to like reoccurring constantly?
Yeah, and there's a lot of reasons why people failed in this space. I think a lot of people didn't focus on the fundamentals of cashback and rewards. My team and I, like, you know, a little bit of backstory. We had built a company previously called Cosmic. And Cosmic was the leading e-commerce gateway. We were one of the inventors of the buy button that let people buy from any website, no matter if the merchant was selling on that site or not. It also let merchants sell their products anywhere. So different channels in video and ads, blog posts, wherever they were, they didn't have to sell directly on their site. They could sell anywhere. So we got to meet just about every retailer in North America, many parts of the world through that, building that business. We were ultimately acquired by our biggest customer, which is PopSugar, to come in and power about $1.2 billion in retail revenue. Got to meet a lot of fashion merchants through that. And then fast forward a little bit.
PopSugar, why do I know that?
They're a big like shopping, fashion, celebrity kind of media publication for mainly targeted at the female demographic. And then fast forward a little bit, Rakuten, Ebates at the time, the biggest cash company in the U.S., many parts of the world, came along and bought us away from PopSugar in another acquisition.
They bought my friend's company too. How funny is that? You know, Unroll Me?
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
My best friend, literally, we were born like in the same hospital together. No JoJo. Way. Yeah. That's his company. He sold it. And that was actually that first time that I realized that you could make significant amount of money from starting an app in your basement was when he sold that company. I'm like, what? How much did you make? Like, you could do that. We were like 18 at the time or something, or 19.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a really interesting technology. We worked with them at Rakuten. But we got to learn how, like, the reward space. We got to learn, talk with just about every merchant in North America. And one of the things that I think where people went wrong is they tried to use like sub-affiliate networks, which have no reliability. You're not working directly with the merchant. Basically, you either have to front all the money, pay all the money, and it's ripe for fraud. And so a lot of companies even today are trying to copy us with that same model because they don't think that we actually work with the merchants. So we called up, you know, when we were building Cosmic, we actually pitched Bitcoin back in the day. This is like 2014, 2015. We pitched it as a payment rail. And I kind of saw firsthand how merchants weren't really going to be that excited about Bitcoin as payments. A lot of them were really interested in the technology, but they didn't have remittance networks set up. And so they were like, okay, if we hold all this Bitcoin, what are we going to do with it? It sounds like a treasury nightmare. Hmm. And the customer didn't want to pay with Bitcoin. There weren't enough users that wanted to pay with Bitcoin. So you've seen a lot of like, you know, Bitcoin payments companies come and go over the years as well that had this promise of sending Bitcoin back and forth.
Yeah.
But on the e-commerce front, a lot of people don't want to pay with Bitcoin because they're basically selling it. And as you know, the best thing to do with Bitcoin is to hold it.
Yes. So that's where you came here to full circle. So when you work with the merchants directly, and now people are spending, instead of focusing on spending Bitcoin, you said, let people spend dollars and get them into the ecosystem this way by earning Bitcoin. It's actually a very different kind of like way about doing mass adoption. It's almost like you're airdropping Bitcoin to dollar holders.
Yeah, cool, that's a good way of looking at it. It's like fiat goes into the shredder, yeah, and then Bitcoin comes out into your Lolli wallet.
You could slowly but surely. I bet you, if you had like merchants that offered percentages for physical items, you're probably having arbitrage already of people buying these items, keeping the Bitcoin, reselling them. And that creates a whole ecosystem in and of itself, especially the discounts that you offer on things like I could just become a travel agent right now and just rebook Marriott for people and make the 8% or whatever it is.
Yeah, you could. We could bring back travel agents.
Hey, I was a travel agent. I was a registered travel agent for like a year and I tried to do it. It's a very hard business to make money.
Yeah.
But I think travel agents are a real utility still nowadays, especially they're more bespoke.
Right.
And that's where I see crypto trading going. But that's another conversation. But I wrote something down that you were mentioning. You said Bitcoin, it's a magnet. I saw a tweet this morning. And the tweet was that, I think it was Raul from Real Vision. He said, if Bitcoin is nothing but a talent magnet for millions of people around the world who want to just work on something really, really cool, that in and of itself makes Bitcoin's value over $20,000 a coin. And I really thought about that while I was driving to work today. And you made me think about that because here you are. You said you and your team were the inventors of the buy button. So here you have like yourselves and other people who are part of bringing the internet to where it is today. And you could be doing anything else, but you want to work in crypto. So here you are. It's like bringing in all these people. And I firmly believe that a lot of the reason that PayPal is doing their whole crypto world that they are today is not because they see the business side of it, but because people who work in PayPal right now, including the CEO of PayPal's son is mining for Bitcoin, they all love Bitcoin. They all love crypto and they want to be a part of that revolution. So you're seeing this like internal revolution in these companies, and I'm not making this up. They're telling me this. Do you see these similar things happening?
Yeah, and we saw it back in the day when we were building Cosmic, because when we went to go pitch Bitcoin, we would find these low key Bitcoiners that were like, look, man, I'm trying to sell like internally. No one's listening. They think we're crazy. And then now we're talking to those same people who, you know, have done very well personally in Bitcoin. And they've like infiltrated the biggest merchants in the world. And they're like, you know, selling this dream. And so one of the innovations of Lolli is that we're the easiest company to sell to merchants, if you think about it. Like, we have more merchants on Lolli than any other crypto company in the world, and the biggest merchants in the world. And it's arguably because it's the easiest way to sell it. We don't have to deal with payments. They have to take on no risk. And so they're just working with us on a rewards engine, rewards platform, which they're used to are already doing with you know, sites like Rakuten and Honey. And so if we come in and we're like, look, we're just like them, except we're bringing this whole new market, which you can attract without having to, you know, really do anything, you know, they get pumped up. And even over the last like 2 years since we launched, it's been really interesting to see the merchants or the individuals at these merchants that previously weren't into Bitcoin. You know, we'll go send them the Bitcoin standard, or we'll send them, you know,
different Bitcoin. That's why you send them the Bitcoin standard. Just joking.
Yeah. What do you recommend I send them?
Bitcoin billionaires, I guess.
Yeah.
Because I'm different. I like to read through novels. Some people do. Some people like stories and things like that.
Yeah, I'll start sending both. So we send them Bitcoin standard, and then they start to see their sales going up, and you know, Lolly, like, you know, surpasses a lot of their expectations that they thought, because I think a lot of people think that, oh, it's just this, you know, new startup. How big could Bitcoin be? And then they see that we're actually driving a lot of sales their way. And then it piques their interest. Then they read the book. Then they get into Bitcoin.
Oh, interesting.
And so over the last 2 years, I've converted so many of these merchants to Bitcoiners independently. So if you play this out, you know, 3, 4, 5 years, you know, when we've generated hundreds of millions of dollars in revenue for these merchants, which we're really not too far from, when I go to them and I say, hey, you know, we've driven a lot of sales your way. Let's actually go bigger. Let's give you guys the ability to accept Bitcoin. And then I think, you know, 3, 5 years, maybe it's 10 years, who knows, giving these merchants the ability to accept Bitcoin, accept other cryptocurrencies.
Yes.
That's when we start to see, yeah, this like probably leaning into hyper Bitcoinization at that point.
Well, so I've tried to get a lot of those merchants on board all those years ago. And so thank you for getting them on board. But one of the biggest things I would tell them is, hey, you have all these Bitcoiners who have Bitcoin, who want to spend their Bitcoin. But I found that to not be the case. Like you said, most people want to hold. But when you're right. One of the merchants, you can really kind of say the same thing. You have all these Bitcoiners who want to spend their money on merchants that are offering cash back in Bitcoin. So here's a great example. Like I'm on Lolly right now, and I've been buying all my shampoo on Amazon, and I'm telling you, I've been buying like fucking acid. My hair has been falling off. I think it's fake. Because I used to buy my shampoo at Supercuts, but I can't go there anymore. That's another story. I got kicked out. Dude, I should have like untold stories of Charlie's non-crypto life, because that's another show in and of itself.
Yeah, we got to see. That's reality television.
But here we go right here. I'm on harrys.com. You offer up to 27% back, and I could get all my men's, you know, grooming products right here and earn a crazy amount of money back. How do you like, first of all, why are these guys offering such a big discount? And like, what was it like going to this merchant, Harry's, for example, and convincing them? Like, tell me a story.
Yeah. So there's a lot of good examples here. Like, a lot of them, you know, a lot of these relationships, as you know, like a lot of businesses is just building these relationships with people. And, I, you know, with, without trying to sound like too big of a, like too cocky, you know, my team and I have made these merchants an absurd amount of money over the last 9 years of building, you know, Cosmic, building at PopSugar, building at Ebates. And so the initial, you know, the initial merchants that came on because we had made them a lot of money, and they were like, okay, Alex and the team are building another company. You know, we trust them. You know, we're going to go give them our business. And I positioned this very similarly to Rakuten, to other cashback sites. And that was very intentional. And so we actually tried to look as close to Rakuten as possible, because it was existing business model. And I'm a big believer in behavioral change happens not from like complete shifts. It happens from taking things that people are used to and then repositioning them or slightly altering them. And that's how we get, you know, mass adoption.
Where we are, yeah.
And we can, you know, introduce Lightning. We can introduce these like, you know, world changing, you know, technologies on, you know, on chain or, you know, second layer solutions over time. But the way we do that is take something like that already exists. I mean, Cash App has done it. PayPal's about to do it. You're taking things people are used to, like, you know, Venmo and Cash App and these sort of things. You know, these are things that people do every day. And when you start to add this like incentive mechanism on top of something that someone's already doing, that's when you have real change. So, you know, where we're going to see the biggest shift for payments in the future is, you know, when we go to these merchants and we say, you know, hey, Harry's like, if somebody paid with a stable coin or paid with Bitcoin, and because it's a better currency, you, and you don't have to pay the credit card companies, you know, if you can decrease the cost of, medium of exchange and actually pass that back and give someone an incentive for paying with Bitcoin or incentive for paying with a stable coin, that's how you have real crypto adoption on the payment side. But to answer your question, I mean, let's just, some of these stories, let's say like booking.com is like one of our like, you know, best partners. And, you know, they like, he was a big believer in us, you know, in the early days, you know, our lead over there. And, you know, when he first like, you know, decided to work together, he was like, if Bitcoin tanks, I'm never working with you again. And was like, you know, very much like was not a big believer in Bitcoin. And Bitcoin at the time was probably around like, I think it was like 3,500 or 4K. And so as our relationship has grown, we've sent them a lot of, you know, a lot of sales, and Bitcoin has gone up.
Oh, wow.
We're like best friends. You know,
I didn't realize it was 7% back on booking.com. I actually need to book a hotel right now I have to go to Baltimore. So here we go. I'm going to do it on booking.com and earn 7%.
Yeah. And that's
back.
A limited time. So like
it's huge.
Yeah. And booking.com is the biggest, like, you know, travel booking in the world. So
there's one thing that we've never, that we didn't touch on. Well, there's a lot of things that we didn't touch on, and I really, really want to harvest. Sorry to interrupt you, harbor on this point is the biggest reason this is the better way to buy, to earn. The reason that earning Bitcoin is a better way is because you don't realize the price that you're buying it at. Every day, Bitcoin is volatile. You've heard dollar cost averaging and you don't have the discipline to do it. This is how you do it. This is how you do it. And I've been talking about sportsbet.io and their clubhouse, which is a huge community. When you play, when you make a bet, when you do a spin, they pay you with free hands, cash back, and bets. You can play all sorts of games, and they've been doing this for so long in a free, fair, and transparent way on the blockchain. Well, that's not why I'm excited today and why I'm talking to you about this. Because now they're taking this community to the next level by sponsoring the Southampton Football Club. You're talking about millions of British football fans can now see the Bitcoin logo on the front and the sleeve of also the Walford Football Club. I mean, how amazing is that? You're talking about not sponsoring your company. You're talking about sponsoring Bitcoin and crypto. Millions of people around the world are now going to be seeing this and joining the sportsbet.io clubhouse to earn more points, to play games, and to be part of that community. There's really no other way that you can use and spend your crypto and then actually earn more back and be part of this whole community. So listen, make sure you guys join sportsbet.io/podcast. Give them the support that they deserve because they're supporting us and me. Go play some games, get some free hands, get some free spins, and make sure you check them out and support them on the Southampton Football Club's first game, whenever that's going to be. Check it out. It's a crazy world when I tell you that everything we say, do, hear, see, sleep, everything that we interact with the world is being constantly listened to, packaged up, and sold to other people without our permission. But we already know that. You're not in your head. We know that. Why are we okay with it? We shouldn't be. We're not getting paid for any of that. Well, my sponsor, permission.io, actually a very cool company, and you could check them out at permission.io/Charlie. They figured out a way for you to get a piece of the action because advertisers are going to be targeting you no matter what. And now you can decide which advertisers are able to do so by granting them specific permission, and then you get a piece of the action. So you're like basically earning rewards for doing what you already do online, consuming the content and sharing all your favorite information. Now, right at this minute, only these tech giants are profiting from your data. You have all these like Cambridge Analytica and all these like crazy files that are coming out with how our data is being used against us to spin elections and fake news and blah, blah, blah. With my sponsor, permission.io, that is about to change. If anything, check it out. It's so cool what they're doing and how they're doing it. You can get a special sneak peek at permission.io/Charlie. And thank you guys. Thank you, permission team, so much for sponsoring and allowing me to do what I love to do and to do this show.
Hey guys, I'm Charlie Shrem. And Bittrex Global is sponsoring this show. They are amazing. They are the true OGs of the crypto space. Bittrex Global has been around since 2014. I remember when I bought Bitcoin and tokens from them years ago. Listen, they pride themselves on being not only the most safest, secure exchanges around, they also pride themselves on being very heavily regulated to protect your crypto. Listen, from now until the end of the year, they're going to be having no trading fees and no gas fees for you, for my listeners, for all your DeFi tokens. Listen, I even got this awesome sweatshirt for Christmas, and I live in Florida, so there's like no need to even have Christmas sweaters because it doesn't even snow here. Listen, for all my listeners, if you sign up for Bittrex Global and you trade at least $1,000 and you leave your tokens on the exchange through December, they're going to give you $50 in USDT in January just when you sign up at this link that you'll see in the show notes. So if you sign up at this link that you see in the show notes that's linked at the bottom right now, you get $50 for free just for trading. Just for doing whatever you're doing now, and there's no trading fees. So check them out. Bittrex Global. I'm Charlie Shrum.
Exactly. Yeah. If you think about how much every you know, American, everyone in the world spends every single month on travel, on groceries, on anything. And, you know, our average percent across all of our merchants is 7%. So if you just do the math of like, how many years does it take to use Lolli? Eventually, all your money goes into Bitcoin. It's probably about 10 to 15 years, but you know, it ends up, you know, flowing through the system, and eventually, you know, slowly but surely is the saying, right?
I have your next product, by the way, and I know how to do it. And I don't know if I should like talk about it on this show. I can always cut it out. But dude, if you could connect through like, so you know this industry, through like Plaid, you know, Plaid, you connect your bank accounts and your credit cards mm-hmm. to Lolli somehow and do like the whole roundup thing where I'm dollar cost averaging into Bitcoin every time I use my credit card. Can you do that? Because I know there are a lot of apps that are trying to do that in Bitcoin.
Acorns is a massive business, and Acorns is, to my knowledge, US only. They do cash, you know, cash only, cash roundups. And it's an incredible like dollar cost averaging.
Do it with Bitcoin. If not, I'm going to write the app myself and release
it. It's
easy.
On the roadmap.
Okay.
I can say that much. It's on the roadmap.
Okay, cool.
And I think it's brilliant too. Like, you know, dollar cost averaging, if you look over time for Bitcoin, is the absolute best way to get into Bitcoin. I mean, other than buying it in 2010, 2009, you know. So
I want to ask you a question, and I'm going to use the orange juice. I can't even say. I'm going to use orange juice. I moved to Florida too long, so I'm like saying it as one word now.
Yeah.
I'm going to use orange juice as an analogy for my question to you. Orange juice is really good. You have fresh orange juice, tastes great. You know that the more you dilute orange juice and concentrate, the shittier it tastes. You get powdered juice, powdered anything. In the early days of Bitcoin, the message was clear. And the reason I can ask you this question is that in the age of crypto, you and your Twitter account have been very Bitcoin. In fact, you guys just launched the ability to have a sats tag. You guys have coined the term of stacking sats, essentially stacking Satoshis. You've been very big proponents of Bitcoin, and I love that. It's like everyone should follow your Twitter account just for the cultural laughs that you get every single day from whoever writes. I need to hire your content writer, by the way. So the question I have for you is in the early days, the message, all the people who got involved, we didn't come from like other industries. We didn't bring that legitimacy. So we had to like figure shit out on our own. You know, we had to figure shit out on our own, and we broke a lot of things. And then over the years, folks came in like yourself who brought the legitimacy, the talent, the reputational de-risk. So now these other, like you said, there's less risk when other companies want to work with you now because they've worked with you before. So you've reduced that risk. The problem is now when people come in from other industries and they bring their teams and they bring their talent, the message gets diluted, and there's a little bit of assimilation. And I worry that the flair of Bitcoin and the culture is going away. And that we eventually could lose all of on-chainness. You know, eventually, if it's all PayPal's just doing Excel spreadsheet Bitcoin, then what is Bitcoin at the end of the day? Help me quell my fears. I should learn how to fucking pronounce words. I'm a podcaster. Quell my fears.
Yeah, and that's a really astute observation, and it's something that I think is like core to our business is Bitcoin education. And we probably, you know, could have made more money if we had done, you know, offered a shitcoin or can I curse on here?
Do you know I tried to launch the first shitcoin, but continue.
Yeah, but you also have been a huge Bitcoin proponent. But I think there's all these learnings over the years of just, you know, I've been observing the space for a long time now. And I tried to, you know, do a Bitcoin payments with my last company. I've been a big believer in it, you know, for a long time. And I got into Ethereum and Solidity early on. Our team has built in Solidity. It's, you know, we're not anti, you know, altcoins and stuff like that. Although it does seem like that. I'm all for innovation. Like, you know, the only way that Bitcoin came about was through somebody doing something extremely different. I'm not saying like, you know, ETH is not the answer. I think for the beginner, someone getting into it, Bitcoin is the truth. Like Bitcoin is the best asset. It has already proven its value to society. It is like almost unstoppable, right? Like, and so we've already proven that it's the best asset in the entire world. It's the only asset that like anybody in the entire world can own and trade. Like if you really like take a step back and like think about like the asset that has the most liquidity that anybody can move anywhere in the world, it's already proven that. We're already past that phase. And so if I'm, you know, if you know, you talked about like trust and reputation. If my trust and my reputation is on the line and it's up to us to go to the rest of the world to distribute Bitcoin to people and to airdrop it, it's not creating some alternative token or something like that to give to people. Bitcoin already has value, and we know the monetization tool with cash back as a way to airdrop it to the most amount of people. And so if we're going and giving away like, you know, some made up token or something like that doesn't have value, it's sort of a fool's errand. It's not going to convert as well. If it goes down, if something happens to it, you know, the Lolly reputation is held up by Bitcoin.
I see what your point is, that I completely understand what you're saying. And now if you use some other like coin or whatever, you have to worry about the reputational risk of that coin and what you're doing. Whereas with Bitcoin, it's already been proven that it's the best asset in the world.
Exactly. And there's things like, I mean, okay, my booking.com relationship is interesting, and I'll bring it back up. Because if Bitcoin had been hacked, or if Bitcoin had been 51% attacked like some coins, or you know, if Bitcoin 2.0 has not launched yet, or whatever, you know, is reliant on chain, if I'm going to my booking.com contact and he's like, hey, where's this Bitcoin 2.0? When's it coming? And I'm like, look, I have no control of a decentralized asset. If I'm reliant on something that hasn't been proven yet, like some other coins, then I can't go do my business, which is bringing on more merchant adoption and ultimately having value for the consumer. So when we launched, Bitcoin was at around like 3,500, 4K. Now it's at, you know, 13K. Mm. So already we've proven to our users that they can 3 to 4X their earnings. And it's like 3 to 4X better than Rakuten. Because that's what people care about.
It's worth noting that Bitcoin hasn't even hit version 1 yet.
Very, very fair.
Even like if you download Bitcoin Core, it doesn't even say where it's like 0.8 something, I think. I don't even know. I don't follow Bitcoin Core dev anymore. I used to be the guy doing correcting the typos in the Bitcoin improvement protocols before they were even, because I'm not a coder. I'm the worst. What do you think of Solidity? You brought it up. What do you think of all these blockchains creating their own coding languages? You never see that really be talked about much anymore, but it did come back into the forefront when Facebook talked about Libra. And I was talking to the Libra Association members on the show, and they're really more excited than they are of Libra. They're more excited about the new scripting language that they wrote. And I forgot, is it Rust or Curl or something? I forget the name of it. Not Curl.
I think it is Rust.
Rust, yeah, or something. They're more excited about that. It's interesting, Bitcoin doesn't have that. And Bitcoin also didn't, Satoshi never even said the words Torig complete. It's an interesting thing to think about.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, you see language. I mean, look, If the dream of Ethereum works, I'm all for it. Like, yeah. I'm a big believer that if the dream works, it's going to be incredible. It has not shown it can scale yet. That doesn't mean that it can't scale with ETH 2.0. Doesn't mean that they can't improve it. they're just very, fundamentally, they're very different concepts. Like Bitcoin is so different, like worlds different than Ethereum, but everybody lumps it in the same thing. And so it's like to be, you know, you can be pro Bitcoin and also be pro Ethereum.
There's no, there needs to be a word for it, because like maximalism, minimalism, it's stupid. Like I love, I'm ideologically Bitcoin, but we're also capitalist and we have to work in this industry.
Yeah, I'm pro that? Innovation. Like pro innovation. Yeah, I mean, I think that I'm still waiting on a lot of, you know, Ethereum developments to occur that would make it relevant for our business. Yeah. You know, there's interesting things you can do with smart contracts and rewards. There's interesting things you can do with staking. There's interesting things you can do with lending that are, you know, that you don't have to work with Wall Street. You don't have to work with banks. Yeah. And so if you think about like what we're doing that is so transformative is like when we go into a new country, like even with the US, like we can scale.
I remember
scale.
The day.
What were you going to say?
I remember the day that I stopped becoming a maximalist, but continue your story. You were.
Yeah, we're definitely, I mean, I would say we're purists in that we want, we know that Bitcoin is the best performing asset for the masses. Like it's like people need to get into Bitcoin. They need to understand Bitcoin. And it's sort of the gateway drug into other things. We understand that. We're not
Once
like
naive to
that. Once
you understand Bitcoin, then you can understand everything else. But if you try to understand Bitcoin from understanding everything else first, it's just going to be confusing.
Exactly.
Right for misinformation, brainwashing, and fraud.
If we go introduce, you know, some other, you know, currency, some alternative currency, somebody's learning the wrong fundamentals. And so if they learn Bitcoin, they're learning everything that they need to know. They're learning about sound money. They're learning about economics. They're learning about, you know, self-sovereign, you know, financial systems, open financial systems. And, you know, I'm, you know, a huge believer that people should like, there's so much that can be done in Bitcoin. And there's so many things that have not been built in Bitcoin yet. And if people want to go, you know, move their Bitcoin into other things, they can do it. They can use Lolly and earn Bitcoin, move it into ETH. They can move it into whatever they want to actually, you know, own, but we don't need to do that. It's like, it's our job to bring the masses. I want to go bring on the
You're
next
on
100
front
million
lines
people
right now. You want to
Yeah,
be
we're on the front
the...
lines. And if every time, you know, we've done a survey about, you know, how much people understand about, you know, cryptocurrency, like when you go to the Midwest, when you go to other parts of the world, people don't know about Ethereum, and Ethereum's second place. But 60% of the US, the last poll that we saw was 60% of the US knows about Bitcoin. And this was like this probably about a year
ago.
It's
a crazy number.
And I think it was like 20% knew about Ethereum. So if you're looking at it just like bringing the masses into crypto, bringing the masses into Bitcoin, like you have to start with Bitcoin. And so you know, I believe Bitcoin is the ultimate answer, but I am a big believer that stablecoins will be a huge part of Bitcoin adoption in the long term. And so if you like, you know, when I play out like the payments layer, like when we go to booking.com and we say, you know, we want to be a payments company. We want to give people the ability to pay with Bitcoin. The way that I think a lot of people are going to pay is in their native currency with a stable coin connected to whatever is native to them. Because it, like I said before, rewards are something people are familiar with. US dollars are something people are familiar with.
But wait.
So if
sorry to interrupt you, but rewards and all these, the digital content world, it's still very new. I was looking at pictures of me at Money 2020 in 2012 and 2013, that this whole world didn't exist yet. It's one of the reasons I think Satoshi's an alien, because the Bitcoin was created. It existed for a few years pre-digital content world. Like I'm talking about like no one really used like Facebook that much back then. Like this was like, no one really realizes in the past 8 years how much technology and how much we use the internet has changed. Just watch a TV show that came out in 2012 and you'll see, just look at the cell phones and how little they talk about social media. But now it's everything, right? I believe Satoshi could have been an alien or so extraterrestrial, because you almost needed the digital content world to predate that, like to come after, because if Bitcoin was too early or too late, it wouldn't all work together. And that's why I think, like you said, like Bitcoin hits mass, you said 60%. Dude, two nights ago, I find myself having a shrimp cocktail and a drink in my hand at the former Secretary of State of Florida's house, former Congresswoman, having a drink talking about Bitcoin with Andy Garcia, the famous actor. What world am I living in that I'm freaking having a drink at the Secretary of State's house with Andy Garcia talking about Bitcoin? Could you believe that? We're not even 10 years into this thing.
It's crazy. It's like day one. It's amazing. Day one. Yeah.
So wait, it's so good. So how can everyone follow? Like, what's your Twitter account? Because we talked about it before, and I just want to make sure we have it.
Yeah, it's TryLolly is the Twitter account. Yeah, follow us for the memes, Bitcoin back savings, all that good stuff.
What merchants are the top three or five merchants that everyone that you see like the most demand or the most use on?
Booking.com, Nike, Adidas, Chewy, if you have pets.
Oh, Chewy's a good idea. Why don't I use the Chewy?
Chewy's at 7%, 4.5%, I think, today. Harry's is always a good one. Macy's is great.
What people don't realize,
Sam's Club,
is that if you're spending on all these things over the course of a year and you're earning this back, do you remember those times where Bitcoin like dumped half the price and it went back up 50% the next day? You potentially would get in on that action because, you say, okay, I spent $10,000 over the course of a year with Lolly and they earned an average of $700, right? Like 7% back. That's not saying that you have $700 worth of Bitcoin. If it was over the course of the past year, you're sitting on thousands of dollars worth of Bitcoin between all the volatility.
Exactly.
That's what happened to me. I had $200 worth of Bitcoin because I was spending like a year or two, like a half a year ago on Lolly. It was on a bunch of Marriott bookings.
We need to do like one feature that's been on the books for a while is lifetime earnings on Lolly. So you could see how much your Bitcoin has like total through the life of you using Lolly, you've actually earned, because a lot of people are, you know, a lot of the hardcore Bitcoiners are like, you know, transferring Bitcoin out to their cold storage wallets, which, you know, totally fair and encouraged. But we need to do a lifetime earnings to see how much you've actually earned.
That would be so
and
cool.
How much it's gone up.
That I need to see that. That would be, well, like you could probably view that on the blockchain too.
Yeah.
Alex, thank you so much for taking the time and coming on the show today.
Thanks for having me. Great questions and great ideas. And now I got to go back and build.
No, it's all good. That's the whole point. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, my friend. And I'll see you soon. Be safe.
Awesome. Thanks, Charlie.